Hi, welcome to these deliberations between pharmacology and obstetrics and gynecology. It's a great combination because these are the two departments which seldom get to meet each other. But knowing Dr. Garg, I'm sure that you're knowing about him so much that you'd love to hear him solve some of the controversies which keep coming in my department regularly. So today, Dr. Garg, we'll start something about combined oral contraceptive pills and let's tell them something about how the OCPs are one of the the main instruments which gynecologists use and how they are very useful in so many places in so many disorders of gynecology, but at the same time they have some other benefits apart from just giving the conception benefit, and also there could be some side effects. So Dr. Govind, why don't you just take it from here and tell the students about the way these OCPs take care of the women who are coming to us.
Thank you, Dr. Vij. So we will be discussing in this video about oral contraceptives. So oral contraceptives, I will like to start with the classification and then mechanisms. And then for clinical scenarios, Dr. Vij will come.
Yeah, I'll take over there. Yeah.
So oral contraceptive pills. So as the name tells, they are used for contraception. And three major type based on the clinical classification I'm going, they may be combined oral contraceptive pills. Combined means what are combined? Estrogen and progesterone are combined. Then second may be progesterone only pills. As the name tells, only progesterone is present. These are called mini pills. And third and the most important being the emergency contraceptives. Emergency contraceptives also called as post-coital pills. Or they are also called as morning after pills. Morning after pills. And you can obviously understand after what. Yeah? So after the unprotected intercourse. Okay. So these are the three main type of oral contraceptives. So first of all, I will like to discuss the mechanisms. Yeah. Then we can discuss the clinical details.
Yeah.
So basically, we will try to understand this in the form of a story. Yeah? So first of all, contraceptive, they are preventing the conception. So what is conception? So if we see, this is fallopian tube. My drawing is very bad. This is ovary. This is uterus. Now ovary contains ovarian follicle, which contains ova. This is ova. For pregnancy, when sperm and ovum has to meet. Sperm or ovum meet honge, tabhi to bachcha hoga. So basically, this is a love story between the sperm and ovum. Sperm hero hai, ovum heroine hai. In dono ka aapas mein prem vivah karna hai. So ovum is lying in the ovarian follicle. Ye uska ghar hai, sitting in her home. Sperm, it will come from the uterine side. Vagina ki taraf se uterine side se aaye. To hero idhar se aa raha hai, heroine yahan pe. So first step is the heroine, it will come out of its house. Ye apne ghar se bahar nikal ke fallopian tube mein aayegi. The process called as ovulation. And you know, ovulation require LH surge. Suddenly LH increases, ovulation occurs. Ovum comes inside the fallopian tubes. Now the ovum will start moving. The sperm and ovum, hero and heroine have decided that this is our meeting point. Here we will meet.
Ampulla of the fallopian tube.
Yeah. Yes. So ovum will start moving toward the meeting point here. अब इसकी मीटिंग पॉइंट पे जाने के लिए इसकी सहेलियां मदद करेंगी. अकेली पुराने जमाने की बात है, अकेली तो कर नहीं पाएगी. सो द फेलोपियन ट्यूब मूवमेंट्स विल हेल्प इन दैट. सो ओवम इज मूविंग टुवर्ड द मीटिंग पॉइंट. और ये हमारा हीरो जो है वो यूट्राइन साइड से आ रहा है, वेजाइना के थ्रू आता होता है, वो मीटिंग पॉइंट पे आ गए. नाउ स्पर्म एंड ओवम दे मीट विद ईच अदर, फर्टिलाइजेशन अकर, एंड आफ्टर दैट अ जायगोट इज फॉर्म्ड एंड देन इट विल गेट इम्प्लांटेड हियर. ये दोनों आपस में मिल गए और इन्होंने यहां पर अपना घर बसा लिया. इम्प्लांटेशन मीन्स घर बसा. So, ये इनकी प्रेम कहानी चल रही है, लव स्टोरी चल रही है. Now, what are oral contraceptives? वो जालिम दुनिया वाले हैं जो इनके प्यार को पूरा नहीं होना देना चाहते. So, we want to prevent pregnancy. तो जालिम दुनिया वाले कैसे काम करेंगे? We want to know that. How the oral contraceptives work. So, if you see, जैसे पुरानी हिंदी मूवीज में होता था कि हीरो हीरोइन को मिलने से रोकने के लिए क्या करते थे, सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट पुरानी मूवीज में क्या करते थे, हीरोइन को घर के अंदर ताला लगा दिया, बाहर ना निकल पाए. क्लियर? सो सेम थिंग वी कैन डू हियर. We can prevent ovulation. Ovulation is stopped. Ovum cannot come outside its house. Ovulation cannot occur. So basically, estrogen and progesterone, they exert feedback inhibition. And that will stop the LH surge. And when LH surge do not occur, the ovum cannot come out. Ovulation cannot occur. The most important mechanism. Second thing, दूसरा हम क्या कर सकते हैं? जो इसको help कर रही थी इसकी सहेलियां के meeting point पे पहुंच जाए, we can stop that. So we can change the motility of fallopian tubes. सो इट इज नॉट एबल टू रीच द मीटिंग पॉइंट. द थर्ड थिंग वी कैन डू इज, हम मूवीज की तरह ही करते हैं, जैसे गुंडे भेज देते थे कि हीरो को मारने के लिए, वो उसको मार देंगे, वो मीटिंग पॉइंट पे पहुंच ही नहीं पाएगा. सो वी कैन मेक दिस सर्वाइकल म्यूकस हॉस्टाइल, थिक एंड हॉस्टाइल, सो इट विल नॉट बी एबल टू पेनिट्रेट. स्पर्म पेनिट्रेट नहीं कर पाएगा, और जब वो मिल ही नहीं पाएगा तो कहां से उनका मिलन होगा.
Right. So what we are saying that what Dr. Govind has put in such a dramatic details, which you, I'm sure you'll never forget. So what actually happens that the FSH, when it comes out from the pituitary, it is for making the follicle grow and make the estrogen production, and that gives a feedback to the brain to stop the FSH. And when the LH comes out from the pituitary, it ruptures the follicle and produces a copper suture which makes progesterone, and that now gives a feedback to the pituitary to stop the production of LH. So what are we doing? This estrogen production and the progesterone production, which is happening in the ovary, we give it from outside. So our tablets will be the estrogen and progesterone in the circulation, and they will go and inhibit the LH and FSH. So that's the cause of anovulation. And of course, wonderfully explained that the tubal motility reduces, and the access of the sperms to the uterine cavity, the passage, that is also obstructed by the thick cervical mucus.
बावजूद भी इनका प्यार सच्चा था और वो जीत गए. सो दे हैव फॉर्म्ड द जायगोट. देन व्हाट वी विल डू, फिर हम वही करेंगे जो हरियाणा में करते हैं, ऑनर किलिंग वी विल डू. सो वी विल स्टॉप द इम्प्लांटेशन. सो दीज आर द फोर मेजर मेथड्स बाय विच ओरल कॉन्ट्रासेप्टिव्स विल वर्क. इनहिबिशन ऑफ ओवुलेशन द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट मैकेनिज्म. Then fallopian tube motility alteration, making the cervical mucus thick and hostile, and stoppage of implantation. And it is obvious that stoppage of implantation will be most important mechanism for which pills? Yes, it is emergency contraceptive pills.
Yes.
Okay. So these are the different mechanisms. Now Dr. Vij will explain about their clinical utility.
Right. So like what we understand here is that the estrogen progesterone which we're giving is actually going to give feedback to the brain and stop the LH and FSH. So the estrogen progesterone, which is there from the ovary, usually the ovary is the powerhouse of making estrogen and progesterone. Now what are we doing? We're giving it from outside and we are stopping the LH and FSH. Now I know that my tablet is the source of estrogen progesterone in the woman's body, so I'm very smart here. I do this with the least dose possible. You know what is the dose of the ethinyl estradiol in the OC pill? The ethinyl estradiol is only 0.03 milligrams. In some low dose pills, it is as low as 0.02 or even 0.01 micrograms. So we are giving the least possible dose, isn't it, sir?
Yes.
The least possible dose, because jab pehle bane the OCPs, tab to bahut high dose chal rahi thi, 150 microgram chal rahi thi.
They were causing lot of adverse
effects. Lot of adverse effects. So we saw that the low dose in the OC pill is enough to stop the FSH and the LH. Now, what is the gist of this part of the story? That we have reduced the LH and FSH with the least dose possible. So what is the meaning of it? That in the circulation of this woman, estrogen progesterone is less. It's not very high. So estrogen progesterone in the woman's circulation now is less, and it's in my hand. So what happens? Estrogen makes the endometrium, progesterone makes the endometrium secrete. And when that stops, a woman gets periods. That's what happens in every woman every month. Now, the estrogen progesterone in this woman is because of me. My tablet is the estrogen progesterone in this woman. So what do? I give the estrogen progesterone together just for 21 days. Then I stop. She gets a period on 27, 28 day. Again, I give for 21 days and stop. She gets a period in 27, 28 days. So what does this mean? Her cycle is in my control and I'm giving it for 21 days. She gets a period in 28 days. And a woman who was probably never getting her cycles on time, she's now getting her cycles on time. So that's the benefit of OC pills, that the cycles become regular. Now that, sir, we are giving the low dose, because of the low dose, the circulation has less estrogen. And suppose I give this woman estrogen progesterone, let's say for 10 years in her menstrual life. So for 10 years, the circulating amount of estrogen progesterone in the body has been low. So the estrogenic effects are less. So proliferation of the endometrium is less. So there'll be lesser bleeding. So menorrhagia is less, cycles are regular, endometrial proliferative disorders like endometrial cancer is lesser in women who are taking long-term oral contraceptive pills. And so apart from regularizing the menstrual cycles, there'll be lesser issue in the body. So there'll be lesser endometrial cancer, lesser bleeding, so lesser anemia. Of course, when the ovary is not growing a follicle because the LHFS has stopped, so there'll be lesser ovarian cyst and lesser ovarian cancer also later in life. And there'll be lesser fibroids, lesser PID. And yes, there will be a problem sometimes of gallbladder stones, and there'll be adenocarcinoma of the cervix. It's been reported, but believe you me, that's not a very common thing to happen. Adenocarcinoma of the cervix is reported, but don't think if somebody's taking OCPs,
the old thing, because when lot of estrogen was used.
Yeah, when it was very high.
Now it is very low dose, these carcinomas are very rare.
These are just anecdotal cases. And one thing which I want you to know is there might be some problems of benign breast disease will reduce. But what I was taught, when I was in my MBBS, I was taught that OCPs reduce benign breast disease and they reduce breast cancer. But now we know that the low dose
increase.
Yeah, some people say that increases. Some people say
there's a controversial topic.
Yeah, some people say that the CA breast is not reduced. That much you have to know. There is no reduction in CA breast. The incidence of CA breast because of OC pills might be the same or maybe probably increase,
particularly with high doses.
So we stay with low doses. So the incidence of CA breast is not changed because of this. Dr. Govind, you have such a lovely way to remember all of this, I remember. And you have so many more details than what I've told.
Sir, we'll come to that. But I will like that you should please explain like when to start these pills and what will happen if the woman misses the pill.
Clinical part I'm discussing. So it's best that the OC pills for the best effect, we start them in the first few days of the menstrual cycle. From the first day of the menstrual cycle to the fifth day, they can start at any time. So for convenience sake, we say, let the hormones not interfere in your bleeding. So 2-3 days if you bleed, 3rd-4th day, we can start the OC pills.
This is a source of confusion. Many students keep on asking me that in some books it is written that they are started on the first day of menstrual cycle. Some books say they are started on 5th day of menstrual cycle. That means we can start anytime.
Forget the books. You tell me one thing. If you start at any time during the bleeding, it's not going to change her endometrium majorly. Only thing is, if you start from the first day, the estrogens may come into the circulation and may reduce her bleeding. And a lot of girls feel that, let me have a proper flow at my periods, Yes. Most women would want them to have the normal flow. So let them have the flow. And the 2nd, 3rd day is a decent time to start the pills. And remember that for the contraceptive benefit to start, it takes at least 7 days. For the first 7 days, whenever she's starting the pills, the first time this month she's starting the pills, for the first 7 days of starting the pills, she should use some other method of contraception because the contraceptive benefit is not yet achieved. And one more thing which I want to say is this is the regular way of starting the pills. But Dr. Govind, I have some very young girls sometimes, teenagers who are, sexually active these days, and some uneducated people also, those who are not very well aware that too many children is not good for their life eventually. So the uneducated class and the teenage class, these are the people I start the OCP whenever they come to me. I start protocol is known as the quick start protocol. Whenever they come to me, I start the pill.
Okay.
So they might be, let's say, on the 12th day of the cycle, but I started off.
Yeah, got it.
So what happens?
The risk will decrease.
So I know 12 days have happened in the period. 21 days I'm going to give the tablet. So the cycle, the cycle will go till estrogen progesterone will be till 33 days. And she may get a period on the 40th day this month. But at least I got her.
Yes.
At least I've enrolled in the pill cycle for her. Next time she'll take it on the second, third day of the period.
Then it will be
at least I got these people who would have actually got pregnant. So quick start is for these people whom I want to start the pill as soon as possible. Now the other problem is that sometimes these girls will miss the pills, and it's human nature because sometimes you're not very well driven to take a pill every day. So if somebody misses a pill one day, next day she can take two. Some people say if they miss 2 days, next day they can again take two tablets. But the problem is when 3 or more tablets are missed. So if a woman has missed 3 or more tablets, we say the day you remember, take that day's pill. Suppose I remember after 3 days today. Okay, today's pill I should take. Now it is 3 days since I've missed the pill and today's pill I take. Continue the tablet. Your next whole regime should continue. But now 3 days were missed. So the contraceptive effect has now waned off. So for the next 7 days, when you're taking the pill continuously, for the next 7 days, again, the couple must take another method of preventing a pregnancy because the contraceptive effect has waned off.
So basically, we are continuing these pills so that the menstrual flow is not affected.
Yeah, the cycle will eventually come on time, but the pills will be not very effective if they missed for 3 days.
Basically, we say that assume that this will not work now.
Yeah,
and just continue the tablet so that the menstrual flow is not affected.
Yeah, whenever
and whatever tablet she has missed, we should throw them those tablets.
Yeah, so that it is the cycle should eventually the tablet time should be 21 days.
Yeah.
So if she's missed for a few days, those she can throw and stop at eventually at 21 days so that the period comes on time.
Good.
So you were telling us something about the other benefits we have and a complete list of things, sir.
So I have dwelt a mnemonic to remember these other beneficial effects of OCPs. Sir. So we remember them from the name itself, other benefits.
Oh, very convenient.
Other benefits. So other O means ovarian cyst, as sir has beautifully explained. In ovarian cyst, like particularly in PCOD, so we can make the cycles regular by giving OCPs. Yes. Then benign breast disease, they decrease the risk of benign breast disease. But as we discuss on malignant breast disease, that means breast cancer, the effect is controversial. So they may increase particularly the high dose estrogens.
Sure.
Then E for endometriosis, they decrease the risk of endometriosis. Particularly, they are also used for pain due to endometriosis.
Yeah, so you must know that we always say that ovulatory cycles are regular, anovulatory cycles are irregular. Ovulatory cycles are painful, anovulatory cycles are painless. So cycles have become regular, but anovulation, no prostaglandins, so lesser pain. Endometriosis, there are two problems. One is the pain and one is the disease proliferation. Both are limited by OCPs. It's one of my best instruments to manage young girls with endometriosis who don't want to have a surgery and the cysts are not very big. So I give them these pills, the cycles will be lesser painful. And remember the same principle, the amount of estrogen in the body is more or less, we know it is less. It's in my control, I'm giving only 20 micrograms or 30 micrograms. So the stimulation to these endometriotic spots has now reduced. Estrogen progesterone has reduced, so the disease proliferation is reduced.
Right. Then N for neoplasia. So this is something important. Estrogens, particularly OCPs, they may increase the risk of some cancers and may decrease the risk of some cancers.
Yeah.
As we discussed, the risk of breast cancer may increase, particularly with high dose, and cervical cancer may increase. As we discussed nowadays,
but the adenocarcinoma,
dose is so low, so even that we do not clinically consider. But they have definitively decreased the risk of certain cancers, particularly endometrial cancer and ovarian cancer.
Definitely.
So now many students, they get confused which cancer risk is increased, which cancer risk is decreased. So I've devised a good method. So divide your body from diaphragm into two parts. Upper cancers go up, lower cancers go down. So upper cancers means above the diaphragm we have breast.
So I'm going to use this in my class next time when I
breast
see
cancer increase. And it's a very funny thing. Above the breast you see cervical. Obviously, we are not talking about the cervical, but cervix cancer.
Easy way to remember.
And below that, that means ovarian and endometrial cancer, their risk will decrease.
Right.
Then E for ectopic pregnancy. OCPs may decrease the risk of ectopic pregnancy.
Definitely, they do. Progesterone-only pills, they reduce the pregnancies. So when pregnancies are reduced, the ectopic pregnancies are also reduced. Let's not get into any confusion here that progesterone-only pills or oral contraceptive pills cause ectopics. Please. The net number of pregnancies is reduced. Obviously, ectopic pregnancies will reduce. There's no confusion in that at all.
Overall, obviously.
Overall, the number of pregnancies are low, the ectopics are lesser. So don't say that pill taking will cause ectopic pregnancy. Progesterone-only pill causes ectopic pregnancy. That's actually nonsense.
And I think when we use IUCD, they increase the risk of ectopics?
Now, the same logic works here, sir.
Okay.
Since he brought up a very interesting topic here when we're talking about progesterone-only pills. Now, IUCDs, when you give, the number of pregnancies in the uterus and in the tube again will reduce. Imagine a town of 1 lakh women who are taking IUCDs. And out of 1 lakh women, 100 failures are there. Now, 100 women have conceived while on IUCDs. Now, so where are these pregnancies? 95 of them are in the uterus. 95. And 4 to 5 might be ectopic. So we must remember it this way, that the number of pregnancies with IUCD, low. Pregnancies in the tube, low. If at all they get pregnant, it'll be in the uterus. But rule out ectopic, that's all.
Yeah.
If at all she's pregnant,
just like every pregnancy.
Just like every pregnancy, the chance is a little bit more. If a normal woman, 100 women conceive, you know, any regular 100 women conceive, 1-2% chance of ectopic. If IUCD women, 100 of them conceive, 4-5% of ectopic. So don't say that IUCD increases. Net number is reduced. If at all they conceive, just rule out an ectopic.
So that's basically
same logic as progesterone lipid.
Yes. It. So basically what I told tell in my funny way, when there is IUCD in the uterus, वो कहता है कि बच्चा कह रहा मैं तो होऊंगा.
हाँ.
यहाँ नहीं होने दोगे मैं कहीं और हो
जाता हूँ.
फाइब्रॉइड, they decrease the risk of fibroids.
Yes. Some controversy on this now,
again,
but then this is coming in the journals that there is no effect, but we will still say, I have taught in my recent classes also, that fibroids are low. Yes.
Then I for iron deficiency anemia, they decrease the risk of iron deficiency anemia, basically due to two reasons, most important being cycles become regular, no more over bleeding, and second, we are giving iron for 7 days.
Iron is there, and that is, most people would not take that amount of iron in the regular life, and also, like we discussed, the amount of estrogen in the body is low. So whatever menstruation is happening will happen because the pill you're giving. So that if you understand, then the understanding of the amount of bleeding and the proliferation and endometrial cancer is already taken care of.
Then tension syndrome, premenstrual tension syndrome, risk is reduced. And lastly, risk of one skeletal disease is reduced. Which skeletal disease? Just let me know. Yes, it is osteoporosis, because estrogen, it prevents osteoporosis. You must have heard about postmenopausal osteoporosis, because estrogen was not there, osteoporosis occurred. So if we are giving estrogen, there will be lesser risk of osteoporosis.
Right.
So these are the different benefits of OCPs apart from preventing the conception.
Right, right. But there are some places I would say that you should not start the oral contraceptive pills. Mm-hmm. And those are the patients who are known risk of thrombophilias, or they're having thromboembolic disorders. So those who have hypercoagulable disorders, like thrombophilia,
because estrogen increases the risk.
Yeah, so thromboembolic disease, history of deep venous thrombosis, please don't give. And if a lady is having undiagnosed irregular bleeding, if there's a diagnosed case, like there's a woman who's having menorrhagia and there's no tumor, there's no cancer, and the bleeding is irregular and heavy, then OCPs help us, you know, they will cause the bleeding to be less irregular. But if it is undiagnosed bleeding, please don't give. If the patient is breastfeeding, breastfeeding will actually cease to happen because there is failure of breast, the breast milk formation and breast letdown, milk letdown because of the OCPs. In breastfeeding, please don't give. And a woman,
so
of course,
can we use progesterone-only pills in lactation?
Definitely. We are talking about combined pills right now. So progesterone-only pills definitely are the pills of choice if you want to give oral contraceptive pills for the purpose of contraception while breastfeeding. But definitely do not give combined pills. And we must remember that if a patient has uncontrolled hypertension, she's a chronic smoker, especially after 35. You know, some smoking young women can take OC pills, but too much smoking, that is more than 15 cigarettes a day after 35 years of age, please stop taking the oral contraceptive pills. And a person who is having undiagnosed disorders of the heart, where there is problem of thrombus formation, so those patients should not be taking. And abnormal liver function, that's very important, because you know the estrogens are metabolized in the liver. So the patients with cirrhosis and chronic hepatitis, these patients who have liver cancers also, who are under treatment for that, please don't take oral contraceptive pills. But having said all of this, we must also remember that patients who have sexually transmitted diseases and those who are having PID, OCPs are not a contraindication there. IUCDs could be, but combined pills can be taken.
OCPs can provide benefit in PID.
Yes. That one thing I think both of us forgot to tell that time, I think. They reduce PIDs.
Yeah.
Oral contraceptive pills, the combined types, are known to reduce the incidence of pelvic inflammatory diseases, but they do increase chlamydial infections.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it reduces PID, but chlamydia, the quiet type of PID, that will increase. So one more thing I thought I'll tell here, that is that sometimes you ask that if a patient is breastfeeding, we do not give combined pills, correct? But can she start combined pills sometimes? So 6 months don't interfere in that. After 6 months, she can start. She could actually have a lactation failure after if you give the OC pills. So we tell her that if you give an exclusive breastfeeding and now you want contraception, then after 6 months of exclusive breastfeeding, you can start the OC pills. The other question which came in the exam was, a woman had a choice. She doesn't want to breastfeed. And she's a very active woman and she doesn't want to breastfeed and she wants contraception. So yes, we can start. She has delivered. She has a child. She's not breastfeeding the child. Then she can start the oral contraception.
Because the reason we do not use the lactation failure. Yeah. And anyways, she's not going to breastfeed.
But still we say, sir, that for the first 1 month, let the lochia and all clear off. Let no hormones come in. So 4 weeks. There we say 4 weeks. Yes. And if she's...
So we need not wait for those 6 months.
6 months we don't have to wait. She can start after 4 weeks of that. Yeah. And the next thing they've asked is after abortion. After abortion, as soon as she's aborted, you can start the pill. That is very clear in our minds. But yes, you can say you can wait up to 7 days for the bleeding to finish and let her take the antibiotics if she's taking, let the process of, recovering from the process of abortion, let that get over. If that is the reason, so from the day of abortion to the first 7 days, it can be started anytime.
So lastly, I think from pharmacology, some of the questions are asked regarding adverse effects of OCPs.
Yes, sir,
although
definitely.
Most of them we have already covered.
We have tried.
So we'll try to
enumerate them. I'm sure.
So adverse effects, we can basically divide them into mild, moderate and severe. So as such, there is no such classification, but mild adverse effects means we do not worry that much. If these are present, we will still continue OCPs.
Yeah.
Moderate means here is plus minus. We can stop or we may continue. Whereas severe are those where we will definitely stop. So based on whether we will stop or continue.
Yes.
So mild adverse effects, you can remember they are normally present. So we remember these adverse effects by the mnemonic normally. They are normally present.
Okay.
So N for nausea. Commonly after starting OCP, at the start of therapy, nausea may occur. Then edema. OCPs, estrogens particularly can cause edema. Recurrent headaches. Remember, estrogen is associated with migraine, so some headaches may occur. Then mastalgia, breast tenderness may occur. Then abnormal bleeding. Abnormal bleeding means if the bleeding occurs during first 21 days.
Yeah.
The breakthrough bleeding. So at the start of therapy, it may happen, then gradually it will solve. And lastly, if there is loss of withdrawal bleeding, that means even in those 7 days, the bleeding do not occur. At the start, that may happen, I think, sir.
Actually, what happens that abnormal bleeding is more, since we are enumerating for all the combined pills and the progesterone pills, so you must understand that abnormal bleeding is more with the low dose and the progesterone pills. The low dose combined pills and the progesterone pills. So the low dose pills, the estrogen is only 10 or 20 microgram. So sometimes this breakthrough bleeding can happen because the amount of estrogen to maintain the endometrial blood supply is low. Yeah, so that's what is the problem with these low dose pills. And you rightly put the last point also regarding that.
Now, moderate adverse effects, basically these are cosmetic adverse effects. We remember them as ABC, A for acne, B for bulky. So this is just to remember that it can cause weight gain, and C for chloasma, the pigmentation. So these are nowadays lesser because we are using
photosensitivity,
high generation progesterones we are using nowadays. These are moderate. That means we, in consultation with the female, if she is worried about her facial appearance, and we can stop. But otherwise, if we do not stop, she will kill us.
The bulkiness, like you were saying, that the weight gain, you must remember that there is a tendency to weight gain, but that tendency you can increase by eating too much along with those pills. So yes, the tendency is there, but if you keep a check on the carbohydrates, too many carbohydrates and the fatty food, then that weight won't increase. So don't be scared if you're giving somebody OC pills. Don't tell her that weight gain will happen. But yes, if she has a tendency and she's not going to take care of her diet, then she is going to become obese. Yeah.
And severe, where we need to stop, these we remember from 4 C's.
Yeah.
The first C is cardiovascular, sir, as beautifully explained. OCPs increase the risk of thromboembolism. Yeah. So if there is any case of MI, stroke, DVT, we will stop them.
Definitely.
Then second C is CNS. OCPs, they do not increase the risk of depression, but they can unmask the subclinical depression. So if a female is showing the depressive tendency, we usually avoid giving OCP.
Also, CNS reminds me, I forgot to tell you about migraine with aura. Those who are having migraine, especially with aura, they should not be taking in the contraindications. Thanks for reminding, Dr. Govin. That was wonderful.
That's the that's the advantage of sitting together.
Integrating things, right?
Then we have cholestasis.
Right.
OCP should be stopped whenever any symptoms of cholestasis starts. And lastly, we already discussed some cancers, particularly breast cancer with high dose estrogens and adenocarcinoma of cervix.
Right.
So these are the major adverse effects of OCPs, which are commonly asked in the MCQs.
Right. So, Dr. Govind, I think we did a fairly long discussion, and I think that was informative in many ways, in the pharmacology and the mode of action manner, and also in the manner of knowing the clinical benefits and the adverse side effects and the contraindications of the combined pills. And we also touched a little bit about the prostanoid pills and a bit about the IUCDs. And I hope you people got a fair amount of idea of these drugs. And we are available on the PrEPladder forum and on the Facebook and also on the emails. So
I think we'll stop with this, sir.
Yeah. So we'll come back with some more interesting topics. Until then,
thank you very much and all the best.
Bye-bye.